My name is Sylvia Puente, and I've been asked to moderate this panel. I am the executive director of the Latino Policy Forum. How many of you have heard of the Latino Policy Forum? Yay, that makes me happy. If not, go to latinopolicyforum.org and you'll be kept apprised of all the issues that the forum works on. We work to improve early education, promote affordable housing, just immigration reform, and strengthen the Latino community. And we do this with an agenda that really is built by our community leadership. We have 100 organizational members who are our partners and who we work with on a regular basis to really help articulate what a Latino agenda and the policy concerns or issues are, both in Chicago and in our state capital. So this afternoon, I'm tasked with being your moderator, and we have our legislators sort of going in and out, but we do have a hard stop at about 3. So I thought we would get started, even though some of our legislators are just coming in. So I'm going to tell you what makes me most excited. Before some of you were even born, I met a bunch of students from Jones High School here. How many high schoolers are in the house? Whoa, look at this, representatives. We are shaping this next generation of leadership. We're so happy that you're here. Now, what makes me most excited is way back in 1982, I had a job in Springfield. I left Chicago, I took a third of a cut in salary, and I moved from Chicago to Springfield to work in government for probably about 5 years of my career. At that time, there was only one Latino in the legislature, period, in either house, in the House or in the Senate. As of January of this year, when we inaugurated our new legislative leaders, we now have 18 members of the Latino Caucus. This is phenomenal. 18 who have agreed to work together, and while they work on many issues, they are committed to working on issues to advance the Latino community. And their caucus foundation, which includes our legislators, and they each then appoint a community member to be part of the caucus foundation, puts on this fabulous conference. This year, over 1,100 people registered for it. Did they do a good job today or what? Amen. So with that, thank you, Senator Martinez.
I'm sorry.
Let me have them introduce themselves. And I just have a couple of questions. And because we have such a short period of time, a couple of questions, and then we'll open it up to mics. And we are being recorded, so we'll ask you to go to the mics to get your questions, to ask your questions so that you can be heard and the camera can catch you as well. So I'll ask them as they walk in. So let me just ask you as by way of introduction, because we have a lot of young people in the room and we all know who you are, but they may not be as familiar with you or the districts that you represent. If you would introduce yourself and maybe just start by answering for a couple of minutes the first question. For the last several years of the conference, we've been focusing on education, health, immigration, economic development, and housing. Can you discuss how these conversations and the information shared during the conference has influenced your course of action and your decision-making as a legislature? How has the conference impacted the work that you do? And we'll go to, if it's okay, our senior member and our co-chair of the Latino Caucus.
A senior member.
Senior.
I meant senior in terms of tenure and longevity, and still the only Latina in the Illinois Senate, Senator Iris Martinez.
Well, thank you very much, everyone. And I just want to thank everyone. Every year, we continue to grow, and that's thanks to you, thanks to the, you know, helping us get the word out. Bringing people from communities that sometimes don't have an opportunity to come and meet with us. So I'm very happy and thankful to everyone that's here today, and every year it's just gonna keep getting better. So, Being, this is my 13th year doing this. We first started in 2002 when many of us got elected, and we actually formed our Latino Caucus. At the time, we had 12. Now we have 17 members of the Latino. So we're growing also in numbers. We're electing people outside Chicago, which is great because Latinos are everywhere. And I think that as we cross over to, I think many of our communities are not only Latino. There is a lot of information that sometimes we want to be able to bring to these conferences and take back some of the information shared during the course of the day, because there's a lot of things that we get to see and get to hear that sometimes we don't have an opportunity to hear from a lot of you, of what's going on in your school district, what's going on in your neighborhood, what's going on in the area where you live outside Chicago. And you know what? And, the 17 of us represent, a good, size districts. We have over 200, at least the senators have over 200,000 people that we represent. The representatives have 100,000, so it's half of what I have. But you know what? In every part of the state where we are at right now, with the representatives like Crespo, Representative Crespo, and Linda Chapo-Lavia, and Representative Cabello, and Representative Anthony, we're beginning to hear a lot more of what's going on, and we are able to, in a bipartisan fashion, share the information, and sometimes be able to legislate, bring together some real good substance bills that we need to assure that the safety, the public safety, that the appropriations for, what's going on, the school districts are there. It's unfortunate that we've had a very bad year so far, as far as getting our budget signed. But, we're working on it. We're continually, want to make sure that the right thing happens, and that that we continue to, improve the lives, of our constituents out there across the whole entire state, not only in our district. So you are very important to us, because it's this time that we get together. We have this conference. We share. There's a lot of information that's shared. A lot of networking is going on, and I know that today I've already heard of three different things that are going on in areas outside Chicago that I definitely am going to look into and make sure that we can address it. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Martinez. And just to underscore a couple of things that Senator Martinez said, what is also so impressive is, as the caucus has grown, is that it is bipartisan. We now have two Republican members who are part of the caucus. The remainder are Democrat. And we've seen so much of the Latino population growth happening in the suburbs. So that suburban representation is critically important. And one of those legislators is our other caucus co-chair, Representative Hernandez, who the Latino Policy Forum, we thank you for all of your support. And we work very closely with all of the caucus members. Representative Hernandez, will you share with us how this conference has influenced you?
Sure.
And the issues that you work on?
So I do come from an educational setting. So prior to being a state representative, I did work for the school district in Cicero. So I represent city and suburban, Chicago and then West, Cicero, Berwyn, Stickney, Riverside, Brookfield, and then what you call La Villita in Chicago. So I come from an educational setting that really has given me a leg up when it comes to, when I first came into office, the needs or the lack of services that our community, I feel, deserves. So the school setting has helped me recognize that. What I have found once I got into office that the conference has offered me is, it's knowledge, it's concern, it's issues that the community brings to our attention. Today, for instance, this is a focus on technology. And what I have learned through the immigration session that I moderated is that we gotta get better at our website. Just with the presentations that took place today, what we realized is that there was Spanish speaking and English speaking, and we didn't do a very good job of offering interpretation. So what happens is the information gets lost, right? So what we have to do a better job is then maybe perhaps put these presentations so that those can go back to it and get further information, maybe something they missed out. and keep in, keep, you know, recognize that we have to make the language available. We are focused on the Latino community, which is likely Spanish, right? So I assure for next year we're going to do a better job, not only placing the information on the website, doing a better job with our website, right, but also interpreters making them available. And just the one other area that I touched in the past, because of the conference, I have to tell you that I think one of the biggest, in terms just not only legislation, and we've talked about some of the successes, but it's like the Latino Family Commission. Because of that particular legislation commission was created because of this conference. And so that commission offers really to legislators and to the governor's office information on the needs of the Latino community, all right? So once we did that, we actually did pass legislation to create the New Americans Initiative in the governor's office. So do you see what I mean? It's legislation, but that really impacts our community, and it's all a result of this.
That's great. And one of the newest members of the Latino Caucus, and as evidence that not only we are bipartisan, but I believe that there is this thing that we call Latinos de Corazón. And Representative Gazzardi represents a district that is largely Latino, right? So why don't you tell us?
My district.
Yeah. Half of Senator Martinez.
Half of Senator Martinez's district. So Representative Gazzardi, this is your, I don't know if this is your first conference or not.
It's not. I was here last year, but it's my first conference participating as a representative.
What's your takeaway from the conference in terms of how it's influenced your perspective and issues that you work on?
Well, first of all, I'll say that Celia pointed out that many of you all weren't born when she was first working in Springfield. I wasn't born either in 1982, so you know, I think that the thing that has been most striking to me about this conference, I bring that up to say that the theme of today, we're talking about millennials, like we're talking about our generation, right? To you guys who are sitting in the front row, I think I'm more a peer of your guys than I am a peer of the other folks who are sitting up here. And the thing I'll say about it is that, Iris is 31, so she's right.
The thing I'll say about it is that
you guys should be throwing tomatoes at us right now. Like, you guys should be heckling, you should be yelling at us. You should be angry about the state of things in Illinois government. You all especially. I mean, everyone in this room should be. We should all be disappointed with what's happening in state government. But the effects of the failed legislative policies in Springfield are really gonna be felt profoundly by you guys, right? I mean, when we talk about losing funding, the governor cutting funding for the MAP grants, right? I mean, this is, for many of you guys, a ticket to going to college next year or the year after, right? And we're taking that away from you. You should be angry. You know, we talk about how care for children, young children has gone away, right? These are your kid brothers and sisters, and these are your kid cousins who you have to look after because they don't have professional child care services available to them anymore. And they're not getting the same kind of quality early childhood opportunities that every child deserves. I mean, when we talk about how much, a pet issue of mine, how much time you guys are spending preparing for standardized tests in your classes, right, and not actually doing the real meat of learning, right, you should be angry about that. And that's state policy that's dictating that about your lives. So the thing that I'm excited about today's conference is that we have decided as a group, right, that we want to do more to engage you all in this process, that we want to create a voice for millennials in the political process and in the policy process, because we understand that you guys are uniquely impacted by these policies. And I feel a particular responsibility as one of the younger members of the General Assembly to be a voice for the next generation of Latino families. So I'm inspired by that today, and I think we should all be, you know, we should all walk out of here motivated to take action on the things that we're passionate about.
That's great. So Representative Crespo also comes from one of those suburban areas, and the question was, I'm not sure, Representative Arroyo and Crespo, when you came in, is how has this conference influenced you, the issues that are talked about in terms of education and immigration and economic development? How has this conference impacted the work that you do? Representative Crespo?
Well, thank you, number one. Bienvenidos a todos. I think you're the youngest one. I was born in 1898, so I think I'm the oldest member up here on the panel. And just for those of you who don't know me, I represent the Northwest suburbs, Schaumburg, Hoffman Estates, Streamwood, Hanover Park, Elgin, and Bartlett. I think I was the first Latino elected from a non-Latino district, which I think pretty much sets light to the fact that we can compete anywhere and everywhere, something that I always tell to my Latino friends. My background, I was born in Chicago in the Pilsen neighborhood, again in 1898. And when I was like 5 years old, my parents moved to Puerto Rico. Then I came back in 76 to go to college. And my plan back then was to get my college degree and go back home. But then I met a girl who's my wife today, and I'm still here, except when she makes me mad, I always tell her, I'm going back home. I have two beautiful daughters, and my wife is, by the way, I'm Puerto Rican. My wife is Filipino and Polish. So I have two daughters. One is an immigration attorney, and she does a very good job in keeping me abreast of immigration issues in the state. As you can imagine, she's not very happy right now with all this criticism on immigration. And she put something on her Facebook, and she was very critical of the governor. And I asked her to please tone it down, since we have to work with the guy. I currently chair the Appropriations Committee in the House for General Services, so I'm very intimately involved with the budget process. And I agree with you, it's very, very frustrating. I heard someone talk today and hoping that we come to some sort of agreement by January. I'm not sure that's going to happen. Let's just hope it does, but I'm not sure. Just recently, I was appointed chairman of the Education Committee in the House. I'm very involved with education issues, something very important to me. And I think it's something that's very important to immigrants, especially Latino students, because I'll tell you, that's something that no one can take away from you. So it's very important for us to make sure that we provide the access and make sure to make it easier for you to finish school. My take out of this, I'll tell you, I've been in office now 9 years. And you always learn something new. There's new developments out there. You hear about that. But the biggest thing for me is to hear the personal stories. So, you know, and I encourage you, when you come to this event, especially the young students, make sure you talk to the legislators. Whether they're your legislator or not, talk to us. Let us know. Those are the things that get ingrained in our minds when we're out there taking votes. We always remember the faces. We always remember the stories as well. And we always learn something new. I was talking to someone today. Again, I represent the suburbs. I love Chicago. I was born there. But today I heard that, for example, in Chicago, the Board of Education does not have any Latino representation. For some reason, I should have known that. But sometimes in my old age, you have to repeat things over and over again. And it hit me today, especially in Chicago with all the issues. When you consider how many Latinos, I believe the Latino population in Chicago public schools are close to 50%.
It's the largest cohort, and we do have one board member on Chicago public schools. One of seven.
And I'm not sure if, and I think he was a superintendent. He was actually the superintendent at one time. But it's not enough, folks. And we should be angry at us, but I think we should be angry also what's going on in Chicago when you see that. It's very key to have representation. When I got involved in politics 10 years ago, it happened because the mayor of Hoffman Estates just realized when he looked at the village of Hoffman Estates that there was a growing population of Latinos out there, and he wanted some Latino representation on the board, and he encouraged me to run for office, and I did. And I noticed back then that it really made a huge impact having someone with a Latino perspective just talking to the mayor and the other trustees, and we were able to pass some ordinances that would benefit the Latino population. So it's very key. And so again, I take a lot. I hear a lot of new developments. Great to hear from the young students and kids who are out there. But folks, my take today is just to think that we don't have enough representation in Chicago on that board. It's something I think we need to talk more about. Mm-hmm. Thank you again for having me.
Representative Arroyo, what's your takeaway from this conference in terms of the issues that are presented? And
I think this conference is very important. And what came out of the conference in the 10 years that I've been in the General Assembly have been the driver's license. The driver's license was really big. And what Lisa talked about, the Latino Family Commission was formed. It wasn't funded. We funded it a couple of years ago. And now Bruce Rauner chooses not to passed the budget. He doesn't want to sign the budget. We passed the budget already. It wasn't balanced like they say, but we wanted to get to a certain numbers, a certain time to be able to pass something. He wouldn't let us pass it. And also, my colleague Will Gasardi talked about throwing tomatoes. I could think of somebody you guys could throw tomatoes at, and it won't be in this panel. You know, the person that has us hostage, the one that is not raising the number of Latino participation in state government. You know, there's a lot of fault here, but if we wouldn't have this panel, we wouldn't have this conference, we would have been maybe 20 years back behind. You know, the presenter Giselle that spoke over there, she spoke very eloquent. You know, and we have to bring people like that to open people's eyes, Latinos mainly. We shouldn't be considered as a minority no more. We should be considered something else than a minority. We should be with the majority, really. The minority is a majority, but they still treat us as minorities, right? We're tired of being treated as minorities, right? We've done our work. We've helped build Illinois to where it is at today. If the Latino community wouldn't be where they are today, I don't think Chicago would be where it's at today either, right? So I like the concept that Will brought up. I'm going to keep talking about tomatoes until the sun goes down, probably. I wish that when you guys come to Springfield, you do bring a box of tomatoes, and I could direct you to where those tomatoes should go. Right? I think it's on the second floor. I won't mention no names, but there's a second floor there that they could use a couple of tomatoes. But, you know, we're hard working right now to try to get this budget signed. And I think that's the best thing, because if we can't get a budget signed, we can't fund anything. MAP grants, we can't fund. The biggest thing that we had was the child care, this child program that we had to sign, and it wouldn't sign. We had somebody that grew wings and flew away from the 71, right? From 71, we went down to 70. So then that's another one you could throw tomatoes at, right? I'm not going to mention his name. But, you know, we have to put our foot down and get this budget passed before the year so we could get everything funded, the school funded. The school is talking about laying kids off and laying teachers off. I mean, that's incredible. That's incredible to, at this time, at the year 2015, to lay so many teachers off and not have education, and then talk about not passing child care so women can't have money to take their child to the doctor and stuff like that. That's incredible. I don't think that I would have been able to see something like that in this time of year. But we're slowly working away or around Bruce Rauner. Sooner or later, we're going to get what we want. He gets what he wants, and maybe we'll start working going forward to be able to bring, like we say, some projects to our community, to be able to represent our community. And most of all, when I first met with Bruce Rauner, the one thing I told him that he needed to do, I was willing to work with him, but what he needed to do was to raise the number of Latino participation in state government. And he told me, Representative, I am going to do that, and you're going to have a massive number of Latinos coming into the General Assembly and to the state government. I'm still looking. I haven't seen any. So if you guys know of any that came in new, I sure don't know. And I don't know if anybody on this panel have seen any new people coming in of Latino, other than Hugo Chaviano, though. Hugo, thank you for being here. Thank you. Hugo is also a good friend. But work in progress. Mm-hmm. It's work in progress. So that's why we're here. This panel is very important to represent the Latino community. And I believe that the panel grew this year. I think we had a little bit more, and it keeps growing, it's growing. Next year, I don't know, Lisa, maybe you guys are going to have it somewhere else, maybe,
no, if it's too big. Here.
But I think that we're growing, the conference is growing, and we're looking to have more Latino participation and be able to elect more Latinos in the General Assembly so we can have more participation. Thank you very much.
Open this question up to all of the representatives and senators at the table, and then after this we'll take questions, and I'll ask you to line up because we do have to end promptly at 3. So I'd like to ask you all, given the difficult climate that we're navigating, what legislative or budget priorities will the caucus members focus on moving forward? Anyone like to share?
I'll start. I think right now the most important thing is making sure that all of our programs are funded. I mean, right now, from daycare, our daycares, our childcare, our after-school programs, things that are really, really important to every common day, you know, mom and dads that are out there are working hard. We have to make sure that our children are safe. We have to make sure that we have affordable daycares that are out there so people can go to work. But more important, we have to make sure that education is funded at its 100%. Because you know what, when we look at our schools, when we look at our communities, the population continues to grow, our children are growing, and more important is we gotta keep focusing on making sure that this impasse comes to an end and that we start working on next year's budget, but we gotta make sure that the governor signs this budget and let's get, you know, ourselves back to where we should be at.
Anyone else?
Thank you.
So I will second that because you hit it right on the nail, Senator, where the services that currently are offered to our community should be actually increases in funding because of the increase in population. So we have really been hurting over time, at least since I've been in office, just about since day one, it's been always about cutting. But what do you do when you have a growing community like ours? Even if we sustain funding, that hurts us. So we've initially have had a double whammy hit us. So it's been cuts when we really should be receiving increase. So priority, I do believe, you know, it's the everyday. One would think, you know, childcare isn't a common necessity, but it's extremely, you know, it's very much recognized, unfortunately, through what has occurred in this time, that it's an everyday essential in order for people to continue working and heading to self-sufficiency. So this impacts our community, and it does also spill over to our other colleagues. The African American joins us in the same dilemma. These are underserved communities that these type of services are just essential to our everyday life. So I'm in agreement that we must try to maintain the services as well.
You know, as someone who works closely on the budget for the last 4 or 5 years, I think we need to set our expectations. You know, just looking at where we are today, and when I talk to leadership and I talk to the administration, I don't see any end in sight. Even if we were to raise revenue, I'm not sure whether it's an income tax, a sales tax, at $4 billion a year, it kind of puts us where we were last fiscal year. And where we were last fiscal year was still inadequate. So that's a concern. And politically speaking, is there a will to raise revenue? In some cases, there is and there's not. But I think we need to set expectations. Things are very important to the Latino community as far as I'm concerned, as I mentioned before, education. But you know, the thing we haven't talked much about is healthcare, especially with the Affordable Care Act and how it impacts our community, whether you're documented or not. We need to talk more about that and see what's the best way to deliver services. And we have a lot of non-for-profits that help and deliver services in our community. But we need to take a close look at how they're doing that. Because as I walk around, I talk to different non-for-profits, whether the suburbs or the city, some of those are not very well run. When you look and see that their administrative percent, how much they keep for administrative costs, it's around 40, 50%, there's a problem. I'm not saying they're all like that, but we need to have that discussion. We need to find a way to deliver services in a way that gets to the people it needs to get to in a very economic way.
Great. Would you like to add to that, Representative Oroya, in terms of what the budget or what the priorities are moving forward, given the climate that we're in?
You know, I have a priority other than what the budget is. We know what we have to do with the budget. You have two appropriation chairs that draft the budget in the House, Fred Crespo and myself. We've already done that. We've already put the money in there, and the government, again, won't sign it. And we're going to continue. I believe that we need to close some of those loopholes that we have. We're spending a lot of money that we don't need to be spending, and we need to close those loopholes to get to the figure that we need to get so we could have a balanced budget. That's very important, but I have another issue that I would like to also come back to the General Assembly this year when I start back again in January. There's a big epidemic of diabetes in the Latino community, mm-hmm. and we need to be able to bring some money home and have a program that takes care of diabetes, because the Latinos are the number one nationality that has the biggest and the highest diabetes program. And there's no program in the General Assembly for that. The same way we brought money for the Latino Family Commission, the same way we bring money for all the other programs, we should bring $20 to $30 million to start a program with diabetes in the Latino community or wherever.
Mm-hmm. Great.
So that's something that I'm going to work on this year with the Latino Caucus, because we want to make this a Latino Caucus initiative to be able to all of us work on it together, because I don't think that there's any Latino district that doesn't have diabetes in their district, right? So we all have it. It's in our roots. It's where we come from, right? All our parents, the way we have our diet and the way we've eaten, that's what we get, right? So we want to change that way. We want to change the model and be able to start funding programs like that has a lot to do with our community. So that's what I'm going to work on with the help of the Latino Caucus. Thank you.
Questions from you? There's a mic here and there's a mic there. Please, a question, give your name and a question, not a statement, a question, please.
Hi, my name is Mayra Lagunas. I work with the Golden Apple Scholars Program of Illinois. It's a teacher preparation program.
Great.
We recently just opened it up to DACA students, so we're the first of our kind in the state of Illinois.
Wonderful.
Thank you. And I have more information if anyone's interested. But my question is, in the state of Illinois, the average ACT is about 20.7. In Chicago public schools, it's 17.6. In order to become a certified teacher in the state of Illinois, you need a 22 on the ACT. This disproportionately affects students of color, black and brown students. And so I wanted to know if there is an initiative currently, or if this is something you are all aware of, or something that you are working towards to maybe change. As we know, the ACT is a test, standardized test, one day of a student's life. And like I said, it's affecting students of color disproportionately. We already don't have representation of teachers of color in classrooms where their students look that where their students are predominantly Latino and black. And so is this an issue that, or something that you are all, or any of you looking into?
Well, let me just clarify. It's the ACT or passing a 22 TAP. Or passing another exam.
The TAP exam, but the passing rates for the TAP are even lower.
We know they're not good. I know that you are really working on this, Senator Martinez.
There is, and it's this is what we talk about. What do we take when we leave from here? It's this kind of information about the struggles that are going on. And, being in the Education Committee, there is so many things that we need to address, and you're absolutely right. There's just no way, no how, that our schools should be preparing our students to be able to pass this with that or even higher scores, but they're not. And there is a lack somewhere, there's a gap somewhere between what's being taught, really being taught, and our students really being prepared for that test. So again, we are working on it. Thank you for bringing it up again. This session, we're going to continue to address it. I'm happy to work with you and the schools out there, so we can try to find a way that we can make this happen. I know we have some educators here, like Dr. Cruz that's sitting right there. These are things that are important that we need your help on. We can never say that we are experts on every topic out there, but we are definitely interested in making sure that whatever we can do legislatively to make sure that we can impact what, that kind of disproportion area that we have going on right now, so our students can pass, go to college, and graduate from college is what we need to make sure happens. So thank you for that. I'm looking forward to working with you and with the educators that are in this room. We need your help. You need to help us draft what you think is the tools that you need for us to be able to pass the laws and that we can actually hold our schools and our university accountable when it comes to making sure that we got the very best happening for us. So I challenge the educators in this room to work with us on this. And I know I saw Dr. San back there. I know he's back there from Augustine College. There's a lot of people in this room that can really help us formulate that legislation that we need to continue to address this issue.
Representative Creswell?
Maida, right? Thank you for the question. And actually, it's a bigger problem than that, because let's work through this. Let's say we do have a Latino student who passes the ACT or any other test to get to the teaching program. At some point, they have to take the basic skills test to move on afterwards. If they're, correct me if I'm wrong, if they want to become a teacher.
Sorry. Actually, no, the basic skills has now been replaced with the TAP. So it's either the ACT or the TAP, but the passing rates for the TAP are a lot lower.
They're a lot lower, but they're still higher than what they used to be. So the requirement, so we had an issue with the basic skills test, now I know it's a TAP, but.
And it's actually not the case for students of color specifically.
The criteria is higher, which means there's less eligibility and fewer Latinos passing.
Correct.
And the prices are.
And I think that's the point I'm trying to make, that we have a problem that when they get to that
which
point.
Which is what you're saying.
Right, so that's the point I'm trying to make. There's another bottleneck there, that even if they do pass the test, they get to that point, we're screening more of these students who are not making it through to finish the program,
right.
Which is something that we've talked about a lot. And I know earlier today I heard someone talk about grow your own. So the question is, you know, here's the fundamental question. Do you lower the standards, A, or B, do you keep the standards where they are and try to come up with some kind of programs to help students meet those standards? And I think that's the discussion we need to have and find good, effective programs to make sure that we put teachers who are culturally competent in front of our students. But it's a huge problem, not only in the state, but I think throughout the country, that we've created so many bottlenecks that we're not producing. In this state, for example, we're considered an exporter of teachers. We produce a lot of teachers in the state, more than what we need, but for some reason, we're not producing enough black or brown teachers, which is something that's a real problem. And I don't have the answer. I think we just need to come up with good, effective programs. It might be a long-term proposal here, I don't know, but we need to talk more about that.
Mm-hmm. And to the point that we mentioned earlier, I just showed up on my e-alerts that the Vice President of the Chicago Public School Board of Education, Jesse Reese, did leave the board today. So we have no Latino representation.
Well, and I might add that it's not only the board. It's not only the board, but the mayor also put a leadership team together.
Correct.
And I believe there's no Latinos in that team. So now with Jesse gone, it's really
it's dire.
Something that we should be really angry about. It should move up in our priority list.
And
let's move on because we're really running out of time. And to try to get to everyone who's up here, what I'm going to do is ask the two of you to introduce yourselves and give both of your questions, and then we'll have the panel respond, and then we'll go to this last group of questions, and then we'll conclude. Yes.
Sure. Thank you all for being here. My name is Luis Roman. I work at Illinois Action for Children. And I think both of you, some of you mentioned already, we have one, we don't have a spending problem, we have a revenue problem, right? With the antiquated tax system. So I'm wondering, what do you all need from us to talk to the families and the communities that you work with to when we start talking about taxes? Because I think right now in Cook County specifically, right, the county board just raised taxes, the mayor just raised the property taxes. The taxes are a scary thing. What do you need from us to help you pass new revenue in this state?
So just in the interest of time, let's hear the other question, and then we can go to what are the tactics that we need to pass new revenue.
Okay, I'm Mary Beth Welch, and I'm with Youth Connection Charter School, which I know you guys know, Youth Connection, but at any rate, we serve dropouts, 4,000 plus dropouts in the city of Chicago through 20 campuses. And my question has to do with equalizing the funding for education across the state of Illinois. And if that's being, if that is on the front burner, as I think it needs to be.
Okay, so either question would like to respond?
Let me talk about, Senator Menard has been working on the formula and trying to equalize, making sure that every student across the whole entire state gets the same amount of funding. There should be no reason why Chicago students should be getting anything less than suburban children. I think it should be something that should be across the board. Every dollar spent on a child, regardless of where they're at, is a dollar well spent. But you cannot shortchange the children in the city of Chicago because of the fact that we're in Chicago. I know that when you go outside Chicago, the school districts are much more wealthier. In some cases, they're not. People might think, especially some of those downstate school districts, are not wealthy at all. So again, we have to make sure, and Senator Menard has been working vigorously the last almost 2 years on trying to find something that everybody can be comfortable with, that while, you know, the poorest district should be getting more money and the rich district should be getting less money. That's not the case, and we're trying to equalize that. So we are working on that. It's just that sometimes you just can't seem to get everybody to agree, you know, on it. And let's be honest, shouldn't the poorer districts get more money? I think so. I think that's something that should be, but it's not like that. And we are working on trying to make sure that we can balance that in a way that every child has, you know, the funding that they need, and it follows them wherever they go.
And to that point, as we've had to cut the education budget by nearly $1 billion over the last few years, we have taken, the poor school districts have taken a harder hit and have taken more of a cut than wealthier school districts. And that's how our formula is set up. So how do we get that a little bit more in balance? Those are the questions of tactics in terms of what we do, Representative Crespo. Representative Crespo.
I don't know about the tactic. I'm lost for tactics myself, because I think we're pretty sharp, and our tactics ain't working. But I want to talk a little bit about education. Our education system is broken, right? We got a downstate school system, and we got a City of Chicago school system. And the downstate schools, the state pays for their pensions. In the City of Chicago school system, the teachers pay for the pensions twice. So with that saying, now I just heard now that they got rid of, or Jesse Ruiz resigned, or whatever, they get rid of him, or whatever it is. I want to see an elected school board. That's what I want to see. You want to see education change? You want to see education change? Put an elective school board on the ballot in the City of Chicago, and the school system will change. So we could elect the people that are going to govern and going to oversee the schools. That's what we need to do. Because if you don't even have one Latino on that school board, that's a problem. That's a problem. And until we don't have to start doing that, then maybe we start electing more Latinos to the school board, then maybe we could do something. Thank you.
Representative Crespo.
Thanks. You know, let me at least talk briefly. Luis, where's Luis? You're asking about taxes and what can you do. And I think the key thing about revenue is we need to educate folks, right? Look at our sales tax, for example. So we collect in the state of Illinois 6.25% when you buy something. So most people think that the state keeps 6.25. We collect 6.25. 1% goes back to the city or the municipality where it came from. And in some cases, 0.25 goes to the RTA, which means then that the state only keeps 5% of the sales tax. I would challenge anyone, look at the other surrounding states, Wisconsin, Indiana, and see what their sales tax is compared to ours. Look at our income tax. We collect 3.75, a flat tax, whether if you make $30,000, you pay what? 3.75. If you make a gazillion dollars, you pay what? 3.75. If for someone who makes $50,000 in the state of Illinois, how much do they pay in income tax? 3.75. If you were to live in Wisconsin, you're paying over 7%. So we need to educate folks. But here is the problem, that we have so many units of government in the state. And if you look at your property tax bill, you're going to see, in my case, a mosquito abatement, a township, a school district, a park district, a municipality. And on the aggregate, we collect a lot in taxes. So something that we need to talk about is how many units of government we have, if we can somehow downsize that a bit, and educate folks, because I'll tell you, anytime you mention taxes, people, at least in my district, get angry. Oh, you want to raise my taxes? I'm like, no, I just want to have a smart conversation about taxes. Real quickly on the education issue. I want to acknowledge Veronica Nolan, who sits on the U46 Board of Education, Latina, by the way, so I'm very proud of that. And
the second largest school district in the state of Illinois.
So, in my district, I have three school districts. I'm really proud that I chair the Education Committee. One is U46, also known as the Elgin School District. It's the second largest school unit after Chicago, K-12. I have the largest high school district, 211, and the largest elementary and secondary school district. We talk about Andy Menard's Senate Bill 1, which addresses education formula. And here is, it's a good attempt. I've been very engaged in those discussions as well, but herein lies the problem. In my district alone, when you look at Senate Bill 1, the education formula bill, I have U46 tell me, Fred, this is good for us. Because they would probably be the biggest winner under that Senate bill. Then I have my other two school districts, 54 and 211, to tell me, don't shoot there, because we will be the biggest losers. So that's one of the things that we need to address is, if we do address the education formula, is how are we going to balance this? And we talk about Chicago, and I know that Chicago pays for their own pensions, but Chicago gets a block grant from the state of Illinois. No strings attached, no formula, and the other school districts don't get that. So that has to be part of the discussion as well.
And then can I just add that his explanation shows you the dilemma that we have. Although Senate Bill 1 is something to work with, it doesn't mean that it's ready. It's not ready. What is occurring is I have the same thing. I have losers and winners. So where do we get where everybody wins is the dilemma here. So just recognizing, I guess it's just educating further. Mm-hmm.
Well, the only way we get to win is if we have more revenue.
Okay. We revenue, that's all we need. Let's get those three questions
here. Let's get the three questions. So please state your name and ask your question, and then we'll ask our legislators to respond.
Sure. My name is Alex Medina, and I work for DCFS. I'm also the chairperson of the Latino Advisory Council, and I'm also a pastor in the area of the Cicero, Berwyn, Little Village, and Pilsen area. I actually have two questions, but you decide which one you want me to ask. One has to do with the lives of children, and the other one has to do with fraudulent practices.
It's your question, whatever you prefer.
Either
ask
or?
Both.
Can I ask them both?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So life of children. So children are taken into custody, and most of the Latino children that are coming into the custody of DCFS are from the Humboldt Park area, which I believe is your area, mm-hmm. Senator Martinez. And we have a crisis going on, meaning the children, as they are taken into custody, as we speak, and as we sit and eat our wonderful and beautiful lunch, they are in the shelter for an undetermined number of days because there is zero Spanish-speaking foster homes, which is directly related. That violates the law left and right, if you just don't know about mm-hmm. that. It violates the law left and right. So we are working addressing that issue in-house. However, our part of our strategy needs to be additional support from our legislators. Okay. Coming to the director, coming to the administration and saying, this is not okay, it needs to change 2-3 years ago. Not in 6 months, not in 12 months. So my question is, what kind of a strategy do you have in place to say this, our children, by the way, there is none, except for one person that speaks Spanish, the second shift. Aside from that person, there is no one else speaking to them in their language, feeding them the food that they need to eat to preserve their language and culture. There is none. So I'm looking for a strategy from the legislators. Mm-hmm. Question number two, it has to do with fraudulent practices. I'm a licensing rep with DCFS. Personal experience, in the last 6 months, I have come across two people that have not been licensed, one of them for 3 years, one of them for about 8 months, and yet.
What kind of
they
license?
Were,
what kind of licenses?
Daycare centers.
Daycare
which is a big issue, okay?
Okay.
I'm not quite sure how much you know about this, but this is a big issue. Between the two of them, they have claimed a total of about $370,000 in the last, one person 3 years, the other person in about 8 months. And they were coming to me to seeking licensure. I said no. Eventually, I contacted Action for Children, and we started working that out. However, there is no specific task team. There is no specific strategy in place that will bring DCFS, DHS, and Action for Children to work together and identified what I believe is about 5-10% of these either not licensed or in the process of being licensed that are practicing all of this fraud.
Great questions and great issues. Please.
Hi, my name is Ernesto Saldivar. I'm a teacher at Jones College Prep. I've been teaching for Chicago Public Schools since 2003. And I'm also a 1998 Golden Apple Scholar, so that gives me the foundation and the ability to be critical about a lot of the issues and concerns that directly affect and impact my students. You mentioned about the idea of cultural relevancy. You mentioned the idea of how do we inform and how do we educate our students about issues and concerns that this conference traditionally covers. Well, I think one of the major problems is a lack of ethnic studies across the state, across the nation.
You're right.
Okay. Jones College Prep, we have the ability to say that, you know, I teach Latino literature as a core English class. So my students are getting credit for graduation. It's an English requirement. They need 4 years, and they're fulfilling a state-mandated requirement for graduation. In addition to that, just recently, because they do have a master's in Latin American studies, we partnered with Loyola University, and now they're dual credit. So my question is, what is the state doing in terms of policy to promote ethnic studies so students can be educated about issues and concerns that directly affect them and their identities, their communities? And two, so they can have, how can we help them so they can be informed to address these issues directly? We're talking about them and the empowerment and cultural relevancy. They have it. We, as members who sustain institutions, don't give them the ability to recognize the fact that they have this power and that they have this value. So what are you doing to address that?
Great, and last question.
Good afternoon, Jamila Rashid from the University of Illinois at Chicago. For the past 36 years, the Urban Health Program has existed and has been the tool and roadmap for African American, Hispanic, Latino, Native American students to pursue careers in the health sciences and health professions. We have the third best record in the country as far as graduating those populations in careers in the health sciences. It was created in 1978,
and
it was
question, please?
Created to be held harmless from budget cuts. So that's my question.
Is it being
how
held
might
harmless?
How might a program like that was created, intended to be held harmless, and to increase, it was created to address the healthcare needs of the populations of Chicago, because no one can best serve African American and Latino population than people who are representative of those populations are the ones that's going to go to their communities and practice. And if it's not going to be held harmless, this program is in danger.
Okay, so we have several questions on the table. Who would like to respond?
I'm going
to
start real quickly. I want to address a couple of issues. As the chairman of the licensing and pension, anyone operating out there illegally should be reported, period. I mean, we don't have enough inspectors out there, but I can guarantee you that the minute that that someone is called about an illegal daycare operating, they will be out there. It's a matter, that's why the communities have to be very vigilant of what's going on in your neighborhood. And if something that's going on, guess what? You make the phone call, they will be there. I mean, and if you want to call my office, I'll be the first to call the department and get them out there right away. So let's make sure that anything that you feel is not, that's not right, call the city, the state, federal, whoever it is that you feel that some fraudulent services being committed, make sure that you let the appropriate departments know. Second of all, when it comes to the young lady who talked about at UIC, you know, it's a revenue issue. We have a revenue issue, and until we can address it with trying to find new dollars right now to continue to fund these programs, we are not going to get anywhere, and these programs are going to be lost. You're absolutely right, but there should not be the case. As far as making sure that some of these ethnic classes are being taught, right now, you know, and when I come, education committee, we have legislation that comes forward about you know, Mexican history should be taught, that the history of Puerto Rico should be taught, that the history of Latin America should be taught. You'd be surprised how many suggestions, legislation, people coming forward to us with something, with an idea. We try, you know, it's okay to come and bring it to us. The problem is, again, it's mandates. None of the school districts wants to be mandated because they have so many mandates right now that they have to abide by. And while we think that it is important, because I think it's important that every culture should be taught so people learn to respect the cultures, it's kind of hard. It's kind of hard because there are so many mandated classes that need to be taught right now, that another extra mandate, firstly, is costly, and second of all, again, we're trying.
Can't we change the effect? For example, British literature is for some reason considered part of the core.
Right.
If British literature is considered part of the core,
can I follow?
Why can't Latino? Why
well, African and again,
well, those are actually local school decisions, though,
right?
I think,
that's
right?
The problem. I mean, that we can't mandate, and that's right. The problem. Many of the complaints that we get.
And I think my other colleagues can agree with us, is that every school district doesn't want to be mandated anymore because they got enough on their plate as far as they have to comply. While I understand it, all we can do is continue to move forward and keep bringing in legislation to actually, you know, see if we can have the discussion, because it is important. I remember when Senator Sandoval did bring about the Mexican history, that we should learn more about the whole history about Mexico. That's true. I mean, but again, the will, I think the will is there. It's a matter that people just don't feel right now. School districts are too bombarded with too many mandates right now and just don't want another added one to them.
Representative Hernandez actually has worked and passed legislation that addresses some of this.
So I can tell you that I passed legislation about two sessions ago mandating. There is a mandate, and it was actually for the purposes of the deportation of Mexicans back in the Depression, and it was trying to put that mandated into the books. It was an effort. There was a reporter who was giving out his story. So we actually passed legislation. What we didn't do, and I'll tell you, this is a lot of the problem that we have with our pieces of legislation, is that we don't follow up. Just like the temporary driver's license, there has had to be many workshops afterwards on how to go about the process and how, so it's continuous. What we haven't done is a better job of making sure that the awareness of these type of mandates are being done. And if they're not being done, what do we do about it? So there is a mandate. All right, the question becomes then, is the school following it? Okay, so what I would advise is to look up the legislation. Okay.
They know that it exists, and they know that CPS actually proposed something like that. But if we're talking about promoting assimilation as opposed to being critical about who you are and your experience.
So it's after. It's the aftermath. Right. This is the starter. So from that, what evolves out of that? What are still areas that we have to, you know, work on? So that's a starter point. We need to continue then the conversation. I also just want to add about DCFS. There is the Burgess decree. I'm wondering if that affects it. We have decrees. Decrees are basically mandates, laws that the government, the state has to pass. Or I'm sorry, has to follow. There you go. Okay. Well. Well, so let me answer that. Part of the problem that we have, and there is discussion, is that this current administration has made some changes, all right? Currently, the department, it falls under Department of Human Services, the Office of Latino Affairs, is the office that oversees decrees. Is there anyone assigned to that office? No. Part of the problem right now becomes that we don't have good, solid representation within the system. And that is part of our job. It's not legislation, but it is a means of conversation with the administration, which becomes sometimes a problem. So there is effort, but you bringing this to our attention has to be recognized, and we do need to hear more of it.
Mm-hmm. Great. Representative Crespo, would you like to respond to any of the questions?
I agree with the mandate issue. It's always an issue, and there's a lot of local control. So obviously the school boards decide to make those decisions, which brings to light again, at least in my districts, we have school boards that are elected, and they make those decisions. So we have some control over the curriculum and things like that, because we can talk to the board members. In Chicago, you don't elect your own board, so that's something you might have to look at. So I agree with the mandate concern. The non-compliance, to your point back there, I sit on the audit commission, and so our auditor general, as you can imagine, audits is about every agency in the state of Illinois. They come before our audit commission. It's amazing how many agencies we have that are non-compliance. We just have no teeth to do anything about that. So it's just always a concern.
Shh. So I think we have to conclude. I think our legislators will be available, but we thank you for your leadership, Senator Martinez, Representative Hernandez and Crespo, and our other legislators that were here. Thank you for your participation. Thank you for attending the conference. We know we're in challenging times, and it's clear that there's much work to be done, and we move forward together to make it happen. Thank you.